Thanks for opening your garden gates for us. And now we're going to be talking about a really comprehensive and exciting new book about butterfly gardening in Texas. And I'm really happy to introduce Geyata Ajilvsgi, and I've been an admirer of your work for decades. Your books on Texas wildflowers and butterflies have been amazing. Welcome to Central Texas Gardener.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, your new book is really authoritative and comprehensive. Did you set out to do all things butterfly in one book?
I did. I started noticing that there was a lot of books and butterfly gardens and stuff in Britain, but I couldn't find anything for the United States. And I said, okay, I think they need one.
Well, and you delivered.
I planted a huge trial butterfly garden, and so it just developed from there.
Well, it shows. I mean, the book has not only information about the right plants and the butterflies themselves, but it has really comprehensive lists. It has suggested landscape plantings for different regions of Texas and our region. Really quite amazing in terms of all the preparation that went into this. So it really is a one-stop shop. I congratulate you on that.
Well, thank you.
Now, I want to dive in and just start talking about why this phenomenon of butterfly gardening is caught on, and what is it that we humans can do for butterflies?
I think it has caught on. I think people were ready for something new. They've been birding for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. And along about the time that I wrote the book, the native plant, people are into using native plants now with all the drought and everything. They're going back to that. And I think they were looking for something new, something of interest for the butterflies.
Mm-hmm.
What you can do for the butterflies is, of course, butterflies are kind of like people. They're looking for food. And so to provide the nectar that the adults need and the larval food plants for the larvae.
Right.
Is going to get them into the garden.
Food, and the other things humans need is water and shelter, right?
They do. Water, of course, is important, but it's when you see butterflies puddling and things like that, or a group of butterflies in one place, that's usually the males, and they're there for minerals and salts and things like that,
that
they're getting
instead
of just pure water.
Okay. Now, I understand that some flowers work better than others for attracting butterflies, and you have particular flower colors that you like, too. You like the pinks, right?
It's not me that likes them.
Oh, the butterflies.
It's the butterflies' preference. And their preference, studies have shown that they go to lavender, pink, white, and yellow. And then to blue. There's three things that's going to attract the butterflies to the garden. And first off, it's going to be color and fragrance, because they can smell for a long distance.
I would never have thought of the fragrant aspect of that.
Absolutely.
It makes
absolutely
sense, though, doesn't it?
Yes. That they pick up the fragrance, and then as they get nearer, they see the color. And that draws them into the yard. The thing that's going to keep them there is the nectar.
Okay.
So.
Some of the plants have developed a really complex ways of helping guide the butterflies in, right?
They have. And all of this has been, of course, for the plants, it's pollination. And it was, the plants developed it mostly for the bees, but they have what they call nectar guides. And the butterflies see totally different from what we see. They're seeing different colors and everything. They can see more than we can see. So they can see these nectar guides, which is a different color.
Right.
And some of them are a circle around the throat of the plant. Some of them are long streaks on the lower petals.
On the desert willows, for example, have the beautiful distinctive kind of guide mark.
They do,
one of my all-time favorite plants.
Yeah, and the devil's claw. is really great with that lower lip with the nectar guides on. It's kind of like a little landing platform for an airplane.
Right, you know, right.
The airstrip.
It's amazing how Mother Nature's kind of cooperated. All the different species have aligned.
I think they've all evolved together, you know.
Of course.
Because in the beginning, eons ago, the nectar wasn't in the throat of the flower. It was places along the stem or on the leaves or all of this kind of stuff. And so eventually it got down to, you know, let's make good use of this for pollination.
All right. Well, there in terms of the nectar, there are different factors as well in terms of time of day, if the flowers aged and those sorts of things, right?
It does. Different plants produce different amounts of nectar. It all starts with the soil because, you know, just with people, you are what you eat.
Right, right.
And the plants are what they take up, the moisture and chemicals, the minerals and stuff that, that they have.
Right.
So it all starts with the soil. And that's one of the things, I'll throw this in, about native plants.
Right.
When people bring native plants in and put it into a really rich soil and everything, the nectar content is going to change. It may be better, it may produce more, it may produce less. So you just have to kind of watch your native plants on that.
Try to replicate the soil conditions that they would naturally go into.
Absolutely better, as close as you can. Until, you know, you might try them in both situations and see which works the best. The sun, of course, is and warmth is going to affect the nectar a lot, but there's wind and the temperature and everything.
All the weather stuff, right?
Nectar is basically four different sugars, and they even produce a different amount of nectar at different times of the day. So at one time of the day, you'll see the butterflies nectaring on this plant. At another time of the day, you'll see them nectaring more on this one. So it's very variable in there. And you just have to kind of watch the butterflies and see what they're doing and see what they like.
Sure, sure. Well, and that's the reason why we do all this to begin with, right? Is to observe and to have these beautiful creatures come so that we can encounter them. Now, let's talk about some plants that people should be thinking about that will kind of play out through the course of the year. In the springtime, there are a lot of great flowering trees, like Mexican plum. That's something I think about.
Yeah, the Mexican plum, the spice bush is really, really good. Red bud is good. The wild, here, the escarpment cherry.
Yeah,
is a good one.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
those are some of the trees. Of course, in the springtime, we've just got all kinds of good herbaceous stuff.
Right.
To choose from.
Right. You know, I always see visitors on my Turk's cap.
Turk's cap is especially good for the sulfurs. They, for some reason, they like that. The Turk's cap is the flower, of course, the petals stand up, which makes it butterflies that use that need a longer proboscis to get down to the nectar.
Right.
Some of the larger swallowtails and the larger sulfurs are really, they really like the Turk's cap.
What are a few of your other favorite things to kind of stretch out the seasons, if you will?
For the summer, you can't beat things like tithonia, the Mexican sunflower.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And pintas and... of course, the old standby, the butterfly bush. There's one that it's just recently been used in Austin. It's the sweet almond verbena. And it's a close cousin to our native bee brush, the Aloysia.
Right.
That's really, really, really good. Another one is the Argentina verbena, bonarensis. Sometimes it's called the tall verbena.
Right.
It's excellent for butterflies.
Great, great. Well, even some weeds like thistle are great.
Thistle is absolutely wonderful. It's really, really good. Of course, once you get it, you've got it for life.
You beware. Buyer beware.
Yeah.
I think they're beautiful plants, but they're a little tough to garden around.
They are.
Right,
but they're good.
Right.
And you know, it's a larval food plant for the painted lady.
Well, the book contains information tons of information, not just about the plants, but how to organize the plants and put them together in a way that was going to work for the butterflies. Let's talk about the shelter aspect a little bit, and that's especially important in the wintertime, isn't it?
Well, in the wintertime, the shelter you need for the butterflies that hibernate, that spend their winters in the adult form, and they definitely need shelter, to keep them from freezing to death. But shelter in the summertime is very important too, because a butterfly has to regulate its temperature. It can't sweat like we do and everything. So when they get overheated, they need to go to the shade.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why a lot of times you'll see a butterfly underneath the leaf, underneath the leaf, is to cool off.
Yes.
They also do it by turning their wings straight up to the sun.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's different ways that they do that. But shelter is during storms, a lot of butterflies drowned. They're knocked loose from their support, and so they fall to the ground and drown. So shelter is definitely important.
Right, right. Well, in addition to providing the plants and the nectar, a lot of people like to put out fruit bowls as well and things like that, and that can attract large numbers of different species.
Some species.
Mm-hmm.
Especially the things like the hackberry, the morning cloak, some of the ladies, the buckeyes, and what they do to do that, the fruit needs to be really old, fermented.
Okay,
fruit
fermented.
Is good. Yeah,
right.
Fermented. Mashed bananas, peaches, plums, any of that soft fruit is really, really good.
Right.
And you can mix it up with a little bit of molasses, and what they really like is maybe add some stale beer. and
who doesn't
really
love
like
the mashup of rotten fruit and stale beer?
Right. Right. You know, one of the things, if you look under pear trees and persimmons and things like that, you'll notice the...
The butterflies there. And of course, the book has loads of images and information about the many different species of butterflies. And I know that you probably have, we could spend another day or two talking about all of those different varieties, but we really want to recommend your book and commend it to our viewers out there, because it is right now the most comprehensive thing I've seen on butterfly gardening that exists for our nation. So congratulations to you, and thank you for all the hard work that went into it.
Well, thank you.
All right. Well, Geyata, thank you again for being on the program. Long overdue. Great to see you. And coming up next, it's John Dromgoole with Backyard Basics.